Hi and welcome back to Kalari Lab, Science and Secrets. Okay, so today we're going to talk about something a little bit different. We had our first sessions looking at fascia, and then in the last class we spoke a little bit about ballistic stretching. So we've been focusing on the contractile tissues in the body. Today I'd like us to talk about some of the non-contractile tissues, but still the soft tissues. So of course, bone is a hard tissue, and muscle is a soft tissue, tendon is another soft tissue. Now, I want us to talk today about something called intrinsic equilibrium. Intrinsic equilibrium is your ability of the spine, it's an inherent ability, so it's a kind of built-in ability of the spine to keep itself straight. If we look at the way a cat, when it's thrown in the air, for example, or when it jumps in the air, the way it arranges itself always to land properly. This is because the spine has an ability to bring itself back into straight. And we have exactly the same ability, maybe not as well developed as a cat or other wild animals, but we still certainly have it. Now, before doing this, let's just give a little background to the spine. So of course, the spine is an incredibly important structure in the body, which is giving us, on the one hand, an ability to move, so it's able to be mobile, but at the same time, it's giving a very strong protection to the spinal cord, to the sensory and motor information which is passed back and forth to the brain and to the rest of the body. And it's this balancing of these two functions for which the spine has been perfectly created. It's evolved over many millions of years in order to be a successful system to give us these two things, mobility and protection. Now, the spine is of course made up of different vertebrae. We have 7 vertebrae in the cervical spine. And the last one of those, the lowest one, can be found by if you feel for the vertebra that sticks out the back. We then have 12 thoracic vertebrae, in which you have the kyphotic curve and the beginnings of the lordotic curve, so where the spine comes out and then when it goes back in again, when there's a concave part in your lower back. And then as you go into that lordotic curve, you go into what's called the lumbar spine, where there are 5 vertebrae, and then you have your sacrum at the bottom, 4 vertebrae which are fused together. Now, these vertebrae are different as you travel down. Excuse me. The lower vertebrae are much stronger, or bigger rather, much larger structures, because they have to support a much greater weight on the top. The vertebrae near the top of the spine, so the cervical and the upper thoracic, they are smaller. They are progressively smaller as you go up. And that's to allow greater mobility. We, of course, have to have a large amount of mobility in the neck in order to interact, in order to respond to dangers and move towards objects and so on. So it's this managing of function for which the vertebrae have adapted so that the larger ones and the stronger ones are at the bottom, the smaller, more mobile ones at the top. The angle of the vertebra also changes, so the vertebrae at the bottom are much more horizontal, or level rather, and as you go up the angle increases so that they become, rather than being flat like this, they're actually positioned on an angle like this. And that means that as they move against each other, you get a greater range of movement as you're turning the head. The facet joint between them is given greater mobility. Now, this is the structure of the spine. And the structure of the spine is self-supporting. It will keep itself in that position. Along it, we have many ligaments. Those ligaments joining from one vertebra to the next vertebra. And so on and so on and so on. Some of those ligaments will run from the transverse processes and some from the spinous processes. Now, the transverse processes are little knobbly bits sticking out on the side of the vertebra, and the spinous process is the bit on the back. That's the bit that you can feel. So you have some small ligaments linking one vertebra to another. You also have 2 long ligaments which run down, one just in front of the spine and one just behind. They are called the anterior and posterior longitudinal ligament. So these are the ligaments that we're going to be looking at in a moment. Also, in between the vertebra, we have intervertebral discs. As you probably all know, you've all heard about slip discs. Now, slip discs is a slight misinterpretation. The disc itself does not slip. Simply some pressure put onto the disc, often actually from these longitudinal ligaments which fuse into those discs, they can pull on the disc, or there can be some degeneration in the disc itself. And then you can have pain related to that. A lot of lower back pain can be as a result of this. Now, This is what can happen if the discs themselves are damaged. But prior to getting damaged, they have a system, they have several mechanisms which they use to protect the spine. And this is what we are talking about when we look at intrinsic equilibrium. So, let's divide the spine into two columns to understand this properly. In the front column, you have your vertebral body, the chunky part, the large part of the vertebra. In the back, you have an arch coming out. Now, between the vertebral bodies are where you find the discs. They sit in between. It's this front column that is going to deal with any compressive forces. So if you were to jump up and down and one vertebra pushes down on the one below, you're exerting a compressive force on that vertebra. And that compressive force is going to be dealt with by the disc. It does that in several ways, two main ways. The first one, inside the disc, there is a nucleus pulposus, and the nucleus pulposus, which is in the center of the disc, is surrounded by fibrous layers of annulus fibrosis, which are arranged in concentric rings. Now, when a force comes down and squashes onto that disc, imagine I am the nucleus pulposus, and surrounded by my annulus fibrosis. And above me is the base of one vertebra, and below me is the top of another vertebra. I'm existing between. So when I get squashed, the reaction of the annulus is to simply move out the way, move away from the point which is being compressed. If you imagine when that disc is compressed, most likely it's going to be compressed more on one side or on the other, more on the front or more on the back. It could be straight down the middle, but probably slightly more to one side than the other, just because of the nature of our irregular activity. Now, as that squash happens, the nucleus simply moves to the side. It moves away from the part of the disc which is being squashed. And then as the pressure is removed, it pushes its way back into the center. It pushes against the annulus fibrosis which is around it. Now what that means is it pushes the disc back to being in its original size. The disc, therefore, not losing size, doesn't cause a shortening of the spine. And it's only because of that that the compressive forces that we get don't make us shorter every time we jump up and down. So that's the first mechanism. Simply put, as the nucleus is squashed, as the disc is squashed rather, the nucleus moves away from the area which is squashed, moves into the annulus. As the pressure is removed, it pushes back on the annulus and comes back into the center. Now, if a greater pressure is applied, a pressure which is too great for this mechanism to negotiate, to manage, then there is another system that can be employed. And what happens is the nucleus gives off water. That water moves through the annulus and into the bone. So the porous bone absorbs the water away from the disc. Now, if you think of that disc then as a wet sponge, which has given off water, it can now be compressed yet further to a smaller size without causing damage. As soon as the pressure is released, the really clever bit happens. The nucleus is made up of hydrophilic fibers, water-loving fibers. So it draws the water back from the bone and returns back to its original size. So we have our first mechanism and our second mechanism. And in both cases, compressive forces squash on that disc. The disc manages that either by moving the nucleus moving out the way or by the nucleus giving off water. And when the force is removed, the nucleus pushes back into the center or draws that water back in, and it comes back to being the same size as it was before. In so doing, no height is lost. So that's how compressive forces are dealt with, all in the front column between the vertebral bodies and the intervertebral discs. Now, if we move to the back column, we have sticking out from that intervertebral body, we have two transverse processes and a spinous processes. And in between them, there's a foramen, a space. And in that space is where our spinal cord is found. Now, compressive forces were dealt with in the front column. The back column is going to deal with tensile forces. So any twisting forces or turning forces like this. So if I'm to turn to the side like this, if we imagine that sticking out from one vertebra is that lateral process, and on the next one is another lateral process. Those two lateral processes are joined together by a ligament. Now that ligament is kind of behaving a bit like an elastic band. So when it's pulled, it will pull back. It doesn't have the ability to contract by itself, but when it's moved, it can pull back. Now, when I turn therefore to the side, and I twist this one like this, and then I release that stretch, it pulls it back to the front. And the same applies if I turn it the other way, it will pull it back to the front. So if you try now, if you put your arms like this, and you twist one way as far as you can, and then relax. And then you twist the other way as far as you can, and then relax. You'll find the movement back to straight is much easier than the movement to the side, especially if you really, really go into the side here. And then that last bit to come back is much easier. That's because of that intrinsic equilibrium, that returning of the spine to being straight. So these two these sets of ligaments that join the transverse processes together are dealing with rotational forces. If I'm to make a forward bend or a backward bend, then it's going to be the anterior longitudinal or the posterior longitudinal ligaments that will bring me back to straight. Let me explain that. So your posterior is starting here up inside, inside the cranium, so inside the skull, but underneath this occipital ridge at the top of the spine. And it runs down all the way behind all of the vertebra, as I mentioned before, fusing into the discs until it gets to the pelvis at the bottom. Now when I go into a forward bend, that ligament is going to be stretched. And when I release that forward bend, it's going to the stretch loaded into the ligament will pull me back up to standing. Similarly, when I go into a back bend, and I put stretch into the anterior longitudinal ligament, which runs from here all the way down and into my pelvis in the front. When I go into a back bend, the tension I load into the anterior is going to pull me again forwards. So whether I go forward or back, the anterior and posterior longitudinal ligaments will bring me back to straight. If I twist to the side, or if I do lateral flexion to the side like this, then the ligaments that are set between the lateral processes will bring me back up to straight. So all of these tensile forces are managed and negotiated in the back column of the spine by the ligaments joining together the vertebra and by the ligaments going from the cranium all the way down into the pelvis. Okay, so these forces in the back which are working for these mechanisms in the back which are dealing with tensile forces, these mechanisms in the front which are dealing with compressive forces, are all part of intrinsic equilibrium. Now, what is most useful about intrinsic equilibrium is that it provides us with free energy. Ligaments don't have a blood supply, so they don't need an effort from the circulatory system to do this. We don't need an effort from the nervous system because these are not non-automatic. Yeah, so they're not things that we have to think about. This just happens by itself. And there's no muscular contraction involved either. So from an energetical point of view, there is no energy demand on the body. It's essentially free movement. Now, if we're trying to, whether it's yoga or martial arts or dance or whatever it is, the physical discipline that we are involved with, if we can access free movement, free energy, that is of course going to be very useful to us. It means that we can prolong our time of exercise, and we can use, if you remember, we talked last week about the ballistic stretching. Now with ballistic stretching, you need to keep the body released for it to be able to realize that additional stretch. If the body is too tense and you're trying to do ballistic stretching, you're going to have an accident, or an injury rather. It's exactly the same with making the most or realizing this full potential of intrinsic equilibrium. If you have tension in your body, then all of your fascial connections are going to hold and stop the body from being as agile as it can. On the other hand, if you keep the body as loose as you can, if you try not to have any unnecessary tensions, then you're going to find your body can realize all of the benefits of intrinsic equilibrium much better. Okay, so slightly complicated issue that we talked about, but I hope it makes sense. I hope you find it interesting. Please use the forum to ask me any questions you have about this. I'm very happy to answer any. I will open a new tag on there, especially for the science talks. And any questions that you want to ask me, or any information you found out additional to this and you want to share with each other, that would be great as well. Okay, I hope you're well. And until next time, Narekana.